fake truth and fake news and truthiness and the like.
Thinking about how polling is like beer. Today, I want to talk a little bit about polling. So who here has seen some polling in the news and thought, I don't believe that? All right. Who here sees some polling in the news and says, all polling is absolutely junk because they got this wrong? All right, fewer people. That's a positive thing. How polling is like beer. Who likes beer? Now we're talking. I personally have a very fond appeal of beer. I am varied in my preferences. I like IPAs and I like double IPAs and triple IPAs. I've even been known to drink beers from different breweries. I-10, other unnamed breweries at the beach, or even some unnamed breweries out west. All beers are not created equally. So thinking about how polling is like beer, making beer generally is pretty easy, right? You go to the store, you buy your kit, you mix it up with some hot water, and you let it sit there, and you're good to go. Easy. You can do a poll the same way. You can contract with a survey firm that does the IVR or the robocalls, where a little machine, its automated voice, comes and asks you to push a one or a two on your phone. Easy. $1,000, you're good to go. The problem is, making really good beer, like the I-10 that I finished and I don't have any more of, or high quality beer, that's really hard to do. Doing a good poll is similarly hard to do. So thinking about the differentiation across polling sites. This here are some screenshots from 538. Who here has heard of 538? Nate Silver, a few years ago, got himself famous by correctly predicting the states in the 2008 and 2012 elections. What they do on their website is they assess and they rate the different polling organizations and the work that they do. On a little plug for UNF, there we are, a nice A-. Who here would love to get an A- in their classes? A-es are great. Siena College, who here has heard of Siena College? All right. We have some people that are plugged in. CBS, New York Times, who here has heard of them? Right, people have heard of CBS and the New York Times. Rasmussen, who's heard of them? Right. Some people have heard of them. SurveyMonkey, who's heard of them? There we go. And then TCJ Research, who's heard of them? All right, not too many people. If you look over to the right with the grades, there's some A-, then there's a C+ for Rasmussen, an F, and then SurveyMonkey has a D-. The problem is, and this is not entirely your fault, when you see information about polls, how often do people talk about who did them? Very, very rarely. How often do people talk about the methods in which they were done? Yeah, almost never. This here is a couple of the most recent polls that's up on Real Clear Politics. Gravis has done some polls on the governor's race, and Quinnipiac has done a poll after Gillum won the nomination and DeSantis won the nomination. I want you folks to think about polls as not just some numbers that are spit at you about who's going to win an election, but as pieces of information. When pieces of information get sent to you, do you just absorb them and take them in? Heather might say, yeah. They just get kind of cataloged somewhere in there in our little catalogs of colors and fruits. I'm going to ask you to move over to the other side of the brain and try to think critically about it. Now, the folks at Quinnipiac, I respect. They do great work. I want you to look at their polling numbers that was done literally a couple days after the gubernatorial primary. They have 785 LV, stands for likely voters, and they project Gillum at 50% and DeSantis at 47%. Okay, I heard that's close. Within the margin of error, all that's true. Does anything else stick out for you about those numbers? It doesn't add up to 100. So there's 3% of the folks that have indicated some level of uncertainty. I want to ask you guys a question. Who here intends to vote in the fall election in November? Who here knows who they're voting for governor? A whole lot more than 3% didn't raise their hands when they knew who they were voting for. These are things that are red flags. When you're 2 months out from an election and only 3% of the voters don't know who they're voting for, that might make you think. These are things that you guys need to do. You can't just absorb information uncritically, if that's really a word. You need to think about this information and analyze it. I guess I should do a plug. Why is that New York Times link up there? The New York Times has partnered with Siena College, that some of you have heard of, and what they are doing is they're doing live polling updates on their website, The Upshot. We're a part of that conglomeration that's putting this all together. We're doing a lot of the surveys. So you can literally go to The Upshot's website on the New York Times right now, and you can see the congressional districts that they're polling and who and where is answering phone calls, what that's doing to the response rates, what that's doing to vote choice. This is groundbreaking research. It's pulling the curtain back on surveys. Take a look at it. It's fascinating. But I want to talk a little bit about the science and also the art. So I imagine there's some folks here that have a taste for beer and understanding about what's going on in those big vats behind us, right? Sampling and thinking about how you garner these samples for the polls is not that different than beer consumption and beer production. You have to make a choice about who is going to be in your sample. For an election poll, are you thinking about likely voters? Are you thinking about registered voters? Are you thinking about just regular adults? Depending upon what you want to draw inferences about, you need to decide who your population is going to be from which you sample. Much like beer, if you're making an IPA, you need to make sure you have the right hops and the right malt. If you're making a ghost or if you're making a stout or a porter, it's all different. Sample generation, how you construct your data. Where do you get these phone numbers from that you're calling or the email addresses that you're emailing? Are you getting it off of registration lists? For example, the voter file in Florida has a lot of information about all the registered voters. Are you pulling it from there? Are you pulling it from companies that take that and then supplement it with other forms of data? Also, the mode. How are you going to do these surveys? Are you going to poll on the phone? Are you going to poll online? And what some of the weaknesses and strengths to both of those things are. The art. Right? It's not just science. There's a ton of science that goes on behind you guys. I do not have the capabilities to do that. But there's also art that goes into that. There's creativity. There's ingenuity. So we talked about population choice and determining who the sample is and registered voters and likely voters and all that. But how do you determine who's registered to vote and who's a likely voter? Do you look at the actual voter file and the actual registration? Do you ask people? How do you determine who's a likely voter? I asked you folks if some of you raise your hand, are you going to vote in November? A fair amount of you that raised your hands aren't going to vote. For whatever reason. Maybe you decide to move out of Florida. Maybe you decide to go on a trip. Maybe something comes up and you just forget to vote that Tuesday. Maybe you request an absentee ballot and it sits on your dining room table for a couple of extra days. And then next thing you know, the election passed and you forgot to vote. The New York Times and their project that I briefly mentioned earlier, they do a history of vote choice and they combine it with actually talking to the people. That's one way to do it. There's art in there. There's nowhere in any science that says 56-44 is the absolute right way to do it. Sample generation, where do you get these from? New York Times is using L2. It's a sample providing company that has information on folks. When UNF polls, we pull directly from the voter file. There's strengths and weaknesses to both cases. There's different choices. There's an art in that. The mode, whether you're using live callers, actual people, or if it's one of those robocalls, or if it comes online. All those things have impacts on the quality of the data that you're getting on the back end. Absorbing this information one sip at a time. A poll is literally just 1,000 people in a short, brief piece of time, and it's hard to match that mouthful of information to the entire vat of beer that you have behind you. It's going to include some likely voters. It's going to include some people who didn't think they were going to vote, but maybe a candidate knocks on your door in October and they convince you that it's important for you to show up and vote for them. Or maybe you get touched by an advertisement. And it's also going to include some people that haven't even voted yet, not even registered, because they ran into something that motivated them, and they registered, they said, I'm going to vote this election. And nobody would have thought to even reach out to them when they're polling in September or October. Thinking about construction and consumption, much like beer, things can go wrong. If you have a poor combination of ingredients, like too many Democrats or too many Republicans in a poll, it's not going to be right. If you have poor form in consuming the information, much like beer, you have to look beyond the headlines. 50 to 47 is great, but that's only a part of the story. Right? The look of the beer and the color of it is great, but it's only part of the story. How does it taste? Now, there are some assumptions when it comes to polling that we all have to make, but these are similar assumptions as you get with beer drinking. Right? We have to assume people don't lie to us. Now, is that true 100% of the time? Probably not. But it's an assumption that everybody makes. Just like when you show up in the bartender and you ask for an I-10, you're not getting a Busch Light. The sample you collect is representative of the population that you're interested in. So that first beer that you get, and there's a little bit of head on top, that first sip that you take, you're assuming, you know, if you get all foam, that's not representative of the rest of the beer. You need to make sure you're getting some beer in that sip before you can just say, okay, all right, I like this beer, this is a quality beer. Just like when you're drawing your sample, you need to get a group that's representative of the actual voter population, not just 40 of your friends. And then the inferential statistics that I literally spend a semester on, that some folks have sat through my class and are familiar with, you have to assume that the beer is being brewed properly and it's done the right way in order to end up with a good outcome. This here is a little math about margin of error. The more voters, the better is generally true, but the difference between 800, 900, and 1,000 people is very small. Once you get up over 600 people, you get declining benefits of adding more folks to it. So that's also something to understand. Thinking about when polls struggle. Polls struggle when voters struggle. If voters don't know what they're gonna do, how is a poll going to be any better when they're talking to people? Voters struggle in primaries, when there's very little policy difference between the candidates and people haven't been paying attention. Voters struggle when there's little name recognition between the candidates. Down ballot races, city council, state houses, state senates, when you don't know who these candidates are. How is a poll going to do any better if the voters themselves don't know? Or something you guys need to get ready for come November, complicated ballot measures. I could do a talk for 3 hours on complicated ballot measures, and you're gonna get a host of them come November. When polls succeed, when voters are sure about their choices, when there's partisan ballot races, partisan races going on, Democrats and Republicans, that cue, that shortcut that we have, that's really useful. Also, if there's active campaigns, when people are going on and people are giving information so that they can absorb it in a deliberate manner, it helps voters come to conclusions. Also, if there are stark policy differences. There's a governor's race coming up and there are some stark policy differences between the candidates. You're more likely to see more accurate polling in that than you will the primary race that just happened. And then when you have known candidates, the governor's race is one thing. The Senate race, where we have Bill Nelson, a three-time senator, and Governor Scott, you know, been governor for 8 years, much more known candidates, you're going to see much better polling in those races. And then when the science and the art come together, when you're using live callers, when you're calling cell phones, and you're not just using auto dialers to call landlines, when you have skilled methodologists putting this all together, and when you have trusted polling organizations, right? You know, when you come to Intuition and you get a beer, you're going to expect a quality beer of whatever type it happens to be, a stout, an IPA, or a pale ale, or heaven forbid, some form of Belgian beer. You'll know that you'll get a good version of that. What can you guys do? Who conducted the poll? Find out who did it. You know, find out how the voters were contacted. You know, what's their likely voter model? understand polling's limitations. You know, you need to determine if it's credible. Are these things credible? Are the people that did them credible? You know, is this a bartender you know? Is this a beer that you've heard about? You know, when I get I-10, I know what to expect. When I go to my friend's house who's doing home brewing, Lord knows, I just pray I don't get sick, right? At best, and this is from somebody who does this for a living, polling is like a rusty butter knife. It is not a scalpel. There's a margin of error, there's estimations. We're figuring out what people are gonna do before they actually do it. That's really hard. Think about it like a rusty butter knife. You'll get much less upset when a poll comes out and it says it's 51-49, and then a week later during the election, the other candidate wins 52-48. So I ask you guys to do those things, pay attention, think critically about the information you're getting, and show up in November. Thank you very much.
But if it's an actual person, I might be more likely.